Hey friends, and welcome back to Stronger Every Day. My name is Chrissy. It's great to be with you all. So today we are going to talk about overcoming depression and anxiety and what that looks like. So it's not something that's passive, right? If any of us have struggled with depression and anxiety or any mental health illness or any illness, it's not a passive thing. It's not something that you can just sit back and do nothing and expect to get better. Now resting is good for a lot of things, even for mental illness, depression, and anxiety. We've talked about that, giving yourself some grace to rest and relax. However, it's not passive, it's hard work. And I think that's why a lot of us give up early on in our struggle. I know for me, having this disease for 29 years, it has been a roller coaster. And there's been a lot of times that I thought, I can't do this. I'll listen to someone or hear someone's story about how they overcame or how they got better, and my mind automatically goes to, I can't do this. I'm never gonna get better. That's her, that's him, that's not me. And that, my friend, is the devil. He has you where he wants you when you're in that pit, and he's going to continue to tell you all the bad things and all the reasons why it's never going to get better. You can try 1, 2, 3, or 4 different things, and none of them work for you, but they work for someone else, and that in itself is discouraging. What we have to learn is what works for us. So what works for Chrissy? What works for you? For me, over that 29-year period, I tried therapy. I probably went to 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 different therapists. And I seemed to feel better for a moment, and then it got expensive, and then it got time consuming, and so then I quit going, and then I slowly kind of got back into how things were running for me. So my question to you is this. So you hear an encouraging video, maybe hopefully mine is encouraging to you, about how I have overcome depression and anxiety, and you automatically think, that's not me, that's never going to be me, this is never going to work. How has what you have been doing worked so far for you? Because if it was working, you probably wouldn't be here right now, right? Same for me. I would hear stories like this and think, well, that's her or that's him, and that's never gonna be me. And so I continue to be in a pit for 27 years. 27 years I stayed in that pit. Now, there were good days and good moments in between that, but far and few between were those good times. What I've learned is I have to get that mentality of, I can't, it's never going to get better, it's always going to be harder. I've told you in a few different videos that the devil had in on repeat in my mind. You might come out of this, you might come out on the other side, but the next time it's going to be harder, it's going to be longer, it's going to be worse. And I'll be honest, that was the pattern for years. A lot of it is because I think mentally that's what I had in my head. It's going to be harder. It's going to be longer. It's going to be worse. It's never going to get better. Yes, I'll probably come out on the other side. When you've struggled with it for that many years, you know a lot about it, right? You realize that, yeah, it does get better eventually, whether that's a day, a week, a month, a year. But you also know that it's going to come back. And so number one was changing that mindset of stop. With none of this is going to work for me, I'm never going to get better, I'm never going to feel better. Stop the mindset. Realize there is something that will help. I do personally think that there are some people who have tried everything. There's treatment resistant depression. I feel like there's also, on top of that, there's changing your diet might not work for you. Say you have treatment resistant depression, and diet, changing the diet, and I don't mean going on a diet, I mean watching the foods we're ingesting, being more active. Some of those things have not worked for you. I'm not throwing it all on a pill, because I don't believe, I've talked before that I had a conversation with my doctor and she said, you know, the medicine that you take is 30%. So that's 70% that we have to kind of figure out and make up. But we get in a mindset of this is never going to get better. Sure, that's great for her, but it's never going to change for me. What you've been doing obviously isn't working. So why not give it a try? I remember at one point I told my husband, I was like, I'm just sick of trying because nothing works and I'm tired of being let down. And I understand that mindset 100%. The devil had me right where he wanted me. And it was saying, okay, but have you hit it all from all angles? Have you tried it all together at the same time? And the answer to that was no for me. Maybe for you, it's just one thing that you need to change or two things. But for me to heal, it was everything. And what that was watching what I eat, cutting back on sugar, cutting back on crap foods. Do I still eat those things occasionally? I certainly have over this last 2 months of Nick being sick, have kind of picked that habit up. And I'm alert to it now, and so I'm actively watching what I'm doing. But watching what I eat, watching what I drink, as far as trying to drink more water. I'm a huge diet soda drinker, and I know that's not good for you, but that seems to be what's gotten me through the past 2 months. God, first and foremost, let's not forget that God has gotten me through this. Energy-wise, it has seemed to have been diet drinks and Tylenol, just from being sore a lot from just different things. But drinking more water, it's spending more time with the Lord. It's not just reading my Bible, but studying my Bible. It's praying all through the day. I never really got that. Like, how do you stop and pray? It's not that I necessarily stop in the middle of the day and just spend a 5 minute time prayer with God. It's that I'm talking to Him. God, that was you. I know that was you. Thank you, Lord, for protecting me. Lord, I know that was you. Thank you for making that situation work out. Lord, thank you for, you know, maybe I forgot to pack lunch that day. I was in a hurry. There was a lot going on that morning and somebody brought treats to work. You know, we have a decent size office, and so a lot of times people will bring like extra things from maybe a family function or whatever left over. Or sometimes we'll have like a cookout kind of thing where everybody brings a little something for the office. But it's just the little touches of God. And it's thanking Him, realizing those, thanking Him. If it's a situation I'm nervous about, it's saying a little prayer before. Lord, be with me. Just protect me. Keep the situation calm and peaceful. Let's have a good resolution for everybody involved kind of thing. It's not passive. I'm not sitting on my heels saying, well, God, when are you going to act? I'm just going to sit here and wait till you do. God can cure you 100% quick, fast, and in a hurry. However, it's like someone who is on, let's just say, drugs, for instance, and they have no intention of changing. They just want you to fix the situation. So if they get arrested or if they get in a bind or if they need cash to buy drugs and you keep bailing them out or you keep giving them that money to go buy the drug, but then you want to know why they're still in that situation. Well, you're enabling that. You're not doing anything active to help them. You're allowing them to be passive and then you're trying to take it over. And so God, I think, works a lot in the same way with us. Now, He's different in every situation, but, you know, He can't just wait for you to cry out to Him when you decide you haven't talked to Him in 6 months, but now you need Him. And then He helps you and then you forget His name again. We talked in the previous videos about, do you actually know God or do you know who God is? And there's a big difference in that, right? We talked about, you know, I know Dolly Parton, I know Rue McClanahan, I know Betty White, I know Bea Arthur, I know Estelle Getty. If you know who those women are, you know. I don't know any of them, right? I know who they are. I don't know any of them. I don't have a relationship with them. It's the same with God. You know, do you know who He is or do you know Him? Changing my focus when crap thoughts come in, like this is never going to get any better, this video is pointless, whoever I talk to is pointless, it's pointless in trying a new medicine or talking to a therapist or changing what I eat or drinking more water or studying my Bible, all this is so pointless. Have you tried it? Have you tried it all? Because what's the alternative? right? You're going to fight anyway. When you struggle with depression and anxiety, you're in a fight, an active fight every day. You're going to fight anyway. So why not fight to make yourself feel better? I recall telling Nick that I have no fight left. There's just zero fight in me to continue the fight. And I said that for probably 2 or 3 months, that I just don't even care anymore. I just want to go home. And by home, I meant heaven. I don't want to be here. I have zero fight left. And that was 2 to 3 months before June of 2022, when I finally just fell in the floor and just cried. I just bawled my eyes out that I can't do this anymore. Lord, I cannot. Just bring me home. I can't keep fighting this fight. And that's when he said, get up. Get up. I want you to rest. I want you to dive deep in my word. I want you to help people. Help Christians that are struggling with the exact same thing that you're struggling with. You've dealt with it all these years. Let's help them. And God, through using me, not because I'm special or not because I'm some important person, because I'm a vessel that said, here I am, Lord, send me. Here I am, Lord, use me. That he decided, okay, she's listening, we're going to use her. And I've said before that I think he had this call on my life before then, but I wasn't listening. I wasn't ready yet. I have a sticky note in my Bible. It's on the first page. It's here every day when I open my Bible, and it says, God has something prepared for me, but he has to prepare me for it. I'm not saying that he gave me depression and anxiety for 27 years, but I think that because of what I was going through and me having to realize on my own that there are things I can do to make my mental health better, that when he saw that I finally realized the only answer is God and following what he gives me peace about. So maybe it's peace about a medication. Maybe it's peace about not taking medication. Maybe it's peace about certain types of foods to stay away from. Maybe it's peace about certain exercises or certain Bible verses he leads me to, or certain videos or certain pastors, teachers, preachers on that you can Google and watch their sermons. I believe he led us to the church that we're at. It's all those different things. It's certainly not passive, right? It's always interesting to me that we will spend hours learning something, whether it's learning a song or whether it's learning a dance routine or whether it's learning how to play an instrument or how to play a sport or how to do a job or how to do a video game, how to do homesteading, how to do all the tasks. We'll spend days, hours, weeks, and months learning how to do those. But how much time do you spend learning about God, studying your Bible, reading your Bible, praying? How much time do you pour into that relationship? We're quick, and I don't mean y'all, I mean me as well, to this relationship's taken a lot out of me, so let's just not, it's tiring. What I found is all the relationships that I've ever had in my lifetime, the one that has stood the test of time has been God. He's never let me down. He's always been there. And for years, I was a Christian. I loved the Lord. I knew that he had died for my sins. I knew that he rose again. I knew that he loved me, that I was a daughter of his. But I always felt he probably loved everybody else a little more. And that's because I didn't know God. I didn't know the Bible. I didn't know his word. I hadn't spent ample time studying it. Now, there were periods where I would study more than normal, but then, you know, I would pick an activity that turned from his word. It's not always cool to be in certain people's eyes. It's not always cool to be a Christian. It's not always cool to say, man, there's a group of people that I enjoy socializing with, but I know what the topic of conversation is, and it's not right for me. So to stay away from that. It's not always cool to decide not to go to something that you've been invited to, because it's going to be fun, but the topic or the events are not going to be anything that you would go to God with. You know, I always kind of think about this particular event. What would it be like if God was standing beside me? If God was in the passenger seat with me, would we still go? Would we still do this? And sometimes it's hard to stand up morally and say, you know, for me, for Chrissy, that's just not the right thing for me. I'm not saying that I'm better or that there's something wrong per se with the event. I'm saying that in my soul, I don't feel peace about it. So, but in your soul, you do. So you go to that event, you do whatever, but for me, it's not there. And I hope that we can love and respect each other enough to know that, hey, you know, we still love you, Chrissy, but, and we get it. You know, it's not your thing. That's fine. We'll see you on the other side. We'll see you on the next one. And vice versa. You know, if I invite them to something and they're like, that's really not my thing, you know, I'm not going to be like, well, they're just not a good person, not a good friend. It's taking an active role in your recovery. It's taking an active battle in your recovery. It's realizing that you have to have times of grace and times of peace and times of rest, and then you have to have times of standing up and moving forward every single day, knowing it's going to be a battle. I talked in early videos about that I would spend hours just battling all the crap thoughts in my mind. I would fall asleep in tears just repeating Jesus, 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 Jesus over and over and over while trying to get out thoughts about me no longer being here. And it was exhausting. It was mentally, physically, emotionally, and spiritually exhausting having to do that. But I kept fighting. Does that mean the devil doesn't attack me? Absolutely not. He always roams around like a roaring lion looking for an attempt to get you. And he certainly tried to hit both me and my husband in this last 2 months about with Nick's health. And he wasn't winning, but he was in my head longer than he should have been. And what we had to do was fall back on God and say, God, this is in your hands. You're in control of this. Whatever the outcome is, it may not be the outcome we're wanting, but we know you're in control. And that's hard when you're already physically exhausted. You're sick, you're not sleeping, or you're sleeping on a very uncomfortable porta bed kind of thing, or, you know, all the things. But it's spending time with God, spending quality time with God. And I've said this before, and I could not say this enough. What clicked for me is when I said, God's first, and then everything else will work around God, instead of, here's my world, and I'll try to fit God in it. It's realizing, I don't think God sits up there with a checkbook and say, and a little marker and a little checkoff list and says, well, Chrissy only read her Bible for 5 minutes today, so there's an X there. My love meter came down a little bit, right? Tuesday, she read for an hour, so she gets a little check mark, so it came back up a little bit. Well, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, you know, she didn't do anything, really. She prayed a little bit, but that's not good enough. You know, I think that's man-made, right? Well, you should spend an hour a day studying, praying, reading. You should pray at lunch. You should... No. Yes, you need to do all those things, but everybody's life is different. If you're a new mom to a newborn, your life looks a little different than somebody who's in their 70s. If you have one kid, 8 kids, no kids, 2 jobs, 4 jobs, a spouse, no spouse, everybody's life's different. It's finding what works for you and going at it every day. I've mentioned that there's been times when you have to give yourself a little grace. You're not reading the Bible for God. God already knows the Bible. You're reading it for you. There's times where mentally, I know a lot of us struggle with mental issues that our brains cannot process anything else. Those are the days that I will just turn on some praise and worship music and just start singing, praising the Lord, just singing and praising the Lord, because I can't mentally retain any information that I'm trying to read. it's always a learning you, learning your situation, figuring out what's going to work, and going for it always. Are you going to have setbacks? I did. Are you? You may not. No one's situation is 100% the same. No one's is. There's symptoms that I struggle with that you don't, and symptoms that you struggle with that I don't. Doesn't make anybody any better or worse than anybody else. I was watching a video the other day talking about, it wasn't anything about really anything. It was talking about the way we compare ourselves to people on social media, and we compare our lives to a 5-minute video or a minute video or a 20-second clip, and we think, well, wow, what's wrong with me? You know, she's got it all together, or he has it all together, or, you know, she does all the things. And I can't hardly get, you know, remember to brush my teeth in the morning kind of thing. It's learning that the best advice I can give you is don't compete with anyone. I compete with me every day. I compete to be the best version of Chrissy that I can be. There's no one else out there that's life is anything similar enough on a day-to-day basis to mine to compete with. And so I'm not going to compare apples to bananas, okay? I compete with Chrissy. I compete to be the best version of me I can be. My prayer is that I am as Christ-like on a daily basis, every single day. Understanding that I'm not going to be perfect, understanding that I still have shortcomings, but learning all of those things, learning everything that we talk about. I hope this video helps, friends. It's always my heart and hope that anything that I say can be a little word of encouragement. Without comparison. I end every video this way. It's always my heart and hope that you feel this last part of the video. I've said in so many videos, if you just need to skip to the end, skip to the end. I don't care about the algorithms. I don't care about all of that stuff. I care about you. I care about me. I care about helping people that are in our situation. Skip straight to the end. You're not going to hurt my feelings. God loves you. I love you. Your family, your friends love you, and we need you here. We'll see you in the next one, friends. Bye.